In this Research Methods in Psychology video, we're going to cover research aims and hypotheses, and what the difference is between them. I'm also going to explain the different types of hypotheses and when we would use them. PsychBoost.com, over 170 videos to help you with your qualification, and Patreon supporters can access bonus resources, tutorial videos, and the Discord channel. You might have a general area of psychology that you want to investigate. Say, I want to investigate how memory can be improved. But to give an aim, we need to narrow this down to a clear statement that outlines what you as a researcher intend to investigate. The aim can include why you want to investigate it, so stating the purpose for the study. Purposes could be because previous research raised interesting questions, or maybe you're directly replicating someone else's work. We can phrase an aim as a question or a statement. So an example aim could be, the aim of this research is to find out if colour can influence recall. We can even add, due to previous research showing exposure to green plants increased recall. So with an aim, we know what we're studying, and perhaps why, but not how. We need to be more precise if we're going to conduct a study, and importantly communicate to other researchers exactly what we're doing. So after our aim, we're going to make or formulate a hypothesis. A hypothesis is a precise statement that importantly can be tested. This means I need to state how the parts of the study interact. So in an experiment, I would state in my hypothesis exactly what the levels of independent variables are, and what the dependent variable is. In this example, let's say my hypothesis is there is a difference in the number of words recalled by participants recalling in blue light compared to participants recalling in green light. I would also need to be careful to operationalize my variables, meaning I state them in a way which shows how they're measured. So instead of recall, the number of words recalled. Now, an important point about hypotheses: they're not predictions, they're statements of fact. Now, of course, we reject or accept a hypothesis depending on the evidence we collect. So what's going on? Well, we actually have two hypotheses. As good scientists, we begin with the principle that there is no difference between the conditions, or no relationship between the variables. This is called a null hypothesis, or H0. Of course, scientists want to be able to show that there is a relationship between variables, but similar to a courtroom where they say innocent until proven guilty, we accept the null hypothesis unless we collect evidence powerful enough to reject it. Our other hypothesis you might be more familiar with. It's called the alternate hypothesis, or H1. And this just means it's the alternative to the null. And it suggests that there is a difference between the conditions. It's also known as the research hypothesis. In hypothesis testing, we start with both hypotheses, collect our data, and then use statistical tests on the data. This then provides evidence, and if the evidence is strong enough, we can reject the null hypothesis and accept the alternate hypothesis. I'm going to go into how we decide on the strength of evidence more in the probability and inferential stats videos. So we know the difference between the null and the alternate, but the alternate can be written in two ways. We can give a directional hypothesis, also known as a one-tailed, or a non-directional hypothesis, also known as a two-tailed hypothesis. A non-directional hypothesis states that there is a difference, but not which way the direction will go. A directional hypothesis states that there is a difference and how the results will go. So let's look at my example again. There is a difference in the number of words recalled by participants recalling in green light compared to participants recalling in blue light. There is an increase in the number of words recalled by participants recalling in green light compared to participants recalling in blue light. So by changing the word difference to increase, the second hypothesis suggests that not only will there be a difference, but the direction that difference will go. The researcher will use a directional hypothesis if there's previous research that indicates the direction the results will go. So imagine if there was significant research that being surrounded by green plants improves recall. I might use a directional hypothesis as I have reason to assume the direction my results will go. Bonus fact. I haven't done many bonus facts in the research methods videos, but this one's important and it's about the word prove. We shouldn't actually use the word prove in science. Proven means true, totally true, 100%, absolutely no chance of being wrong. Well, that just doesn't work in science. Any theory has to be open to more evidence coming along and showing it isn't true. That's called falsifiability, and if a theory isn't falsifiable, it isn't science. We have the null and the alternate hypothesis, and we collect evidence so we can reject one and accept the other based on that evidence. Well, how strong that evidence is based on probability. In psychology, we accept the alternate hypothesis when the probability that the results are a fluke is 1 in 20 or less. That means that even when we accept an alternate hypothesis, the likelihood that we just got the results by random chance of 5% or less, never 0%. So accepting an alternate hypothesis because the evidence is strong enough is not proving a theory. It's saying the evidence is not perfect, but strong enough for us to accept it, for now. So my advice in your essays is don't use the word prove anymore, but do say that the evidence supports the theory. It's going to make you sound much more scientific. But you'll now hear and read people using the word prove and proven incorrectly from now on, and I imagine it'll annoy you as much as it does me. So that was aims and hypotheses. I have 6 tutorial videos covering the 17, 18 and 19 AS and A-level research method sections. And these videos have worked examples to every question and are full of exam tips. Patrons at the neuron level and above can access these, as well as many, many more hours of exam tutorial videos, as well as over 100 printable resources from across the A-level over on psychboost.com. I do want to thank all the students and teachers who have supported PsychBoost over on Patreon during the development of the Research Methods Unit. It's their support that allows me to teach part-time so I can make PsychBoost on YouTube for everyone. So thanks to them, and I'll see you in the next Research Methods video, sampling.